You know how sometimes just one little discovery can like totally shift how you see something.
It seems
big.
To be a very interesting
story. Well, that seems to be what's happening right now with some pretty amazing finds in North Africa. You pointed me towards this research on ancient mummies.
Yes, from Libya.
And what their DNA is telling us is, well, it's genuinely surprising.
Yeah.
It really makes you
Asian ancestors
revealed. Early human history.
It really does. This work, mainly from researchers at the Max Planck Institute, it's focused on the genetics of two mummies they found.
Right.
And it's a potentially groundbreaking stuff. We're about to get into findings that really challenge some, you know, long-standing ideas about how early people moved around and interacted.
Okay. So this isn't just about, like, really old mummies then?
Not at all. It's more about maybe rewriting parts of our own story, our deep past.
Okay, let's dive in. So,
Northern Africa.
These mummies were found in Libya.
That's right, at a place called the Takrakori Rock Shelter. It's in the southwest of the country.
And the timing, it's really important here, isn't it? About 7,000 years ago.
Roughly, yes. And crucially, this was during what's called the Green Sahara period.
The Green Sahara. Can you maybe paint a picture of that? Because when I think Sahara, I think sand. Lots of sand.
Right, exactly. But back then, totally different. Imagine lakes, rivers, grasslands, a really fertile landscape.
Wow. So completely unlike today.
Completely. And, you know, that naturally led scientists to assume, well, this fertile place must have been a kind of highway, right?
Makes sense.
Yeah, a corridor where different groups could easily travel, meet, mix, maybe even connect Africa with, say, the Middle East.
It seems logical. A green Sahara sounds like the perfect place for populations to bump into each other, trade, intermingle.
Mm-hmm.
But the DNA from these mummies, it doesn't quite fit that picture, does it?
No, it really doesn't. It kind of throws a wrench in that idea. The genetic profiles of these two individuals, they're surprisingly distinct.
Distinct how?
Well, the really big thing, the headline finding, is that they have significantly less Neanderthal DNA compared to other ancient people outside Africa.
Less Neanderthal DNA. Hang on.
Yeah.
My understanding was always that, you know, modern humans outside Africa picked up Neanderthal DNA from interbreeding events way back.
That's the general picture, yes. Yeah. Tens of thousands of years ago.
So the fact that these North Africans, 7,000 years ago, have less, does that mean their ancestors were somehow separate from that main mixing event?
That's precisely the implication. It suggests their lineage might have branched off before that widespread interbreeding happened, or maybe that the interbreeding wasn't as uniform across all populations leaving Africa as we thought.
Yeah.
It definitely adds a layer of complexity. We hadn't quite appreciated this level of sort of regional variation in Neanderthal ancestry back then.
So if the Green Sahara wasn't this big melting pot, could it be the opposite? Could those green conditions have actually allowed groups to stay put, stay isolated?
That seems to be what the evidence is pointing towards. It's a really powerful implication.
Right.
Nada Salem, who led the study, she talks about a deeply rooted and long isolated genetic lineage.
Long isolated.
Yeah. And that phrase really captures it. Instead of facilitating mixing, the Green Sahara might have been stable enough for certain communities to just stay there, thrive even, and remain genetically distinct for thousands of years, kind of shielded from outside gene flow. It makes you rethink how environment shapes population history.
It's fascinating, isn't it, that a period of like environmental abundance could actually foster isolation, not connection.
It is counterintuitive in some ways.
And the surprises keep coming because their DNA isn't just distinct from outside groups. It's also not quite like modern North Africans, is it? There's a link to someone much older.
Yes, that's another really interesting piece. When they looked for the closest genetic relatives, the signal pointed towards a much older group.
Older how?
We're talking Ice Age foragers from present-day Morocco, people who lived around 15,000 years ago.
15,000, so like 8,000 years before these mummies.
Exactly. And what's really important is that those Moroccan foragers also seem to have been quite isolated, genetically speaking.
Wow. Okay, so let me get this straight.
Two mummies.
These 7,000-year-old Libyan mummies are more closely related to a separate, isolated group from 15,000 years ago in Morocco than they are to, say, other populations living at the same time as them, or even necessarily directly ancestral to everyone in North Africa today.
That seems to be the case. It's a really unexpected link across that much time and space.
It's like finding a faint echo, isn't it?
Yeah.
A genetic thread connecting these pockets of isolated populations over millennia?
Precisely. It paints a picture of these ancient North African groups having this long-lasting connection, maybe geographically dispersed, but sharing some deep ancestry that persisted even while other groups were moving and mixing elsewhere.
Okay, so connection to ancient Morocco, less Neanderthal DNA. Mm-hmm. What about connection south to sub-Saharan Africa? The Green Sahara would seem to bridge that gap too, right?
You'd think so. Logically, a greener Sahara should have lowered barriers.
Yeah.
But surprisingly, the genetic analysis suggests these North African groups remain largely separate from populations in sub-Saharan Africa during this period.
Really? Even with the favorable environment?
Even then. The mummy's DNA just doesn't show significant evidence of gene flow between those regions at that time.
That's another major challenge to the old assumptions.
It is. It makes you wonder what other barriers, maybe geographical, maybe cultural, were still in play, even when the climate was more inviting.
Okay, so if there wasn't large-scale migration bringing new people in, how did things like farming and herding get there? Because we know those practices eventually arrived in North Africa, often linked to the Middle East.
Ah, right. That's where the idea of cultural diffusion comes in. The Max Planck team suggests this is likely what happened.
Cultural diffusion, meaning ideas spread, but not necessarily people.
Exactly. Think practices, technologies, maybe even just knowledge spreading through contact, like traders, occasional travelers, that sort of thing.
Okay.
It doesn't require huge waves of migration and gene mixing.
So maybe some people from the Middle East introduced herding techniques, and the local Tekarkori people adopted them because, well, it worked well in their green environment.
Mm-hmm. Those fertile plains we talked about.
But without a big influx of Middle Eastern genes changing the local population.
That's the hypothesis. The adoption of herding was probably driven by its advantages in that specific environment. A new, efficient way to live.
Mm-hmm.
And that knowledge, those animals, could have spread through exchange rather than replacement or large-scale assimilation. It shows culture and genes don't always travel together.
It paints a much more sort of nuanced picture, not just big migrations, but also this flow of ideas between distinct groups.
Definitely more complex.
Now, these Tekarkori mummies, you said they represent a lineage that doesn't really exist in that specific form anymore. What happened to them?
Well, the study suggests that this particular genetic signature, the unique combination seen in these two individuals, likely got diluted over time.
Diluted how?
By later migrations and mixing events in North Africa. Subsequent populations moved in or through the region over the following millennia.
So they represent a snapshot of a unique group that eventually blended into the broader population.
Kind of, yeah. Their specific branch, in its, let's say, pure form, seems to have disappeared. It's a reminder that even populations that persist for a long time can eventually be absorbed or transformed.
A glimpse into a lost chapter. But you said their genetic legacy isn't entirely gone. It's still part of the mix in present-day North Africans.
That's right.
While you won't find people with that exact ancient genetic profile walking around today, their ancestral genes would have contributed to the gene pool of later populations. So their heritage is still there, woven into the larger genetic tapestry of modern North Africans, even if it's not a direct, unbroken line. It's like a faint thread, but it's part of the pattern.
Okay, let's try and pull this all together then.
Yeah.
We've got these 7,000-year-old mummies from a time when the Sahara was green.
Mm-hmm.
Their DNA is unique, less Neanderthal ancestry than expected. This surprising link to much older Moroccan foragers.
Yeah.
And also distinct from sub-Saharan populations at the time.
Right, a very specific profile.
And all this really shakes up our understanding of North Africa back then. It suggests much more isolation, more independent history than we previously thought.
Absolutely. That's the core takeaway. These findings, being published in a major journal like Nature, they carry a lot of weight.
Yeah.
They directly challenge those assumptions about widespread mixing and movement being the only story. It reveals this more complex, regionally specific picture where isolation was a really significant factor.
It really makes you think, doesn't it? About how many other pockets of humanity, other unique stories, might still be out there, hidden in the past.
It really does. If a place like the Green Sahara, which we assumed would be a crossroads, could actually harbor such a distinct, isolated group for so long, well, what else are we missing?
Yeah.
How many other lost populations might be waiting to be found in ancient DNA, ready to completely reshape how we see our origins?
It's a bit mind-bending.
It is. It makes you wonder. What other fundamental beliefs about our deep history, things we take for granted now, might be overturned by the next discovery? Whether it's in a desert cave or frozen tundra, it shows the story of humanity is definitely still being written. Or perhaps rewritten.